I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Amen. I'm so blessed. I'm so blessed that I'm a part of the family of God. I'm so blessed that I'm a part of what God is doing even in these last days, and that we as a church are a part of what God is doing. I want to bring something today, a word this morning, and I pray that God will help me. I know He will. His word is true. But it's concerning revival this morning. And if you have your Bibles, 2 Samuel chapter 5 this morning. And in this day that we live, we're witnessing a great apostasy. But at the same time, if we're spiritually in tune, we can hear what God is doing. And we can hear the marching orders, if you would, of God. And it's important to us, for us, to understand what revival is and what God is doing in these last days. And I believe that there is one way to do this. And that is just, in all honesty, putting our complete trust in God. And I want to get into it without giving anything away too quickly. But 2 Samuel chapter 5, verse 17 is where we'll begin. But when the Philistines heard that they had anointed David king over Israel, all the Philistines came up to seek David, and David heard of it and went down to the hold. The Philistines also came and spread themselves in the valley of Rephaim. And David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I go up to the Philistines? Will thou deliver them into my hand? And the Lord said unto David, go up, for I will doubtless deliver the Philistines into thy hand. I want you to go down, if you will, to verse 22. And the Philistines came up yet again and spread themselves in the valley of Rephaim. And when David inquired of the Lord, he said, thou shalt not go up, but fetch and come a compass behind them and come upon them over against the mulberry trees. And let it be, when thou hast heard the sound of a going in the tops of the mulberry trees, that then thou shalt bestir thyself, for then shall the Lord go out before thee to smite the host of the Philistines. And David did so as the Lord had commanded him. Father, we thank you today. We thank you, Father, for your word, for your power. We thank you, God, for your Holy Spirit today. Holy Spirit, I thank you for being with us today. I pray that as the word, Father, is spoken, as we have read the word, Father, we would live off of every word that proceeds from your mouth. That, God, that we would not, Father, just try to merely pass it off, but, God, we would truly receive it for the glory and the honor of your name. Build us up, O God. Build us up, Father, as your word says, in our most holy faith, God, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We thank you. We bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. It is something that we get to come in and we get to hear the what the word of God is saying and what God is speaking to us. You know, I truly, the longer I serve God, the more real this becomes to me. The longer I serve God, the more real this becomes to me. There's nothing in life more real than what God has spoken to us through His Word. There is no greater purpose, there's no greater honor for you and I to live in than to live in the purpose and the will of God. Let every breath, everything that we do be for the glory and for the glory of God. Today I want to talk a little bit about what we're listening to, hearing the sound of marching, hearing what David heard in those mulberry trees that day. It wasn't long David had entered into the kingdom. He had been established over Israel as the king. It wasn't right after that the Philistines came up to occupy Rephidim. And they wanted to dethrone David. They had a disgust for David. If you remember, at one point they had an affinity for David, but yet they didn't quite trust David. It was when Saul was going up against the Philistines, and David left Ziklag, and he was in cahoots with the Philistines. And this was even after he had already killed Goliath. But when everything went south, they never really cared for David in their heart. They always kept one eye on him. It's as the old saying goes, that you keep your friends close and your enemies closer. And you know, I see this. You can see this throughout the Word of God. Jesus said, "Did I not choose you 12? And one of you is a devil," right? He said that. And guess who was holding the money bag? The devil. Why? He was keeping him close. He knew what was going on in his camp. It wasn't that Jesus was ignorant. It was that he knew what was going on, and he was teaching you and I something. Something about that when we begin to do good, evil is present. Amen? So David inquired of the Lord, and he was told to go up against them. A bold frontal assault carried the day in that first battle. The Lord delivered them into his hands. It wasn't long after that that the Philistines came up again against Israel again to challenge Israel once again in the same manner. Now, I don't know about you. I think they had learned something. I think that there were other things that were in place. Now, David was a wise king. He was wise in this manner. He knew that if anything was to happen, it was going to be by the order of God. He knew he sat on the throne as king only under the King of Kings. You see, he knew that his kingdom, his authority was only subsequent to the King of Kings, to God Almighty. I love this part because David, the Bible says, as we already read right there, David inquired of the Lord in verse 19 for the first battle. And here's the thing. The Lord answered David and told him what to do. Now, the second time the Philistines had came, they came in the same manner, on the same front. And you know, I think a lot of times we do this same thing. Oh, I won this battle before. And I know how I won it. And I'm not going to even inquire of God because I know how to do this now. You see, and I believe that this is the mistake. I believe that this is the mistake of the church. I believe that this is the mistake of individuals. I believe that when you're facing something and you have an enemy that is set against you like the devil, you need to always inquire of God at every moment, every step of the way. You see, the enemy comes up against him again, and David could have said, you know what, God was with us. We beat this enemy out. The last time, we'll do it again this time. But no, David does something. He inquires of God yet again. And when he inquires of God, God says, no, David, we're not going to do it that way. We're going to do it a different way. This time, what I want you to do is I want you to take a detour. I want you to position yourself behind them, behind the mulberry trees. And until you hear the sound of marching, then you can go forward. See, this was to be the sign that God's host was on the move, and the powers of heaven were going to be thrown into the conflict to secure the victory. Now, I want you to get something before we continue on. You see, you can continue to fight the battle in your own strength if you want to. But if you want victory, you are going to inquire of God and allow God to fight the battle for you, because the battle has already been won. The battle is the Lord's. See, David understood this. Even when he came up against Goliath, he said, the battle is the Lord's, and today God will deliver you into my hands. And so God told him, he says, David, this is what I'm going to do. I want you to take a hold behind the mulberry trees. When you begin to hear those that moving in the mulberry trees, I want you to know that I am on the move. In Genesis chapter 32, we see a little bit and we get a glimpse in to who this host is. Who are these that are fighting on David's side? In Genesis chapter 32 and 1, and Jacob, the Bible says, and Jacob went on his way, and the angels of God met him. So Jacob went on his way, the angels of God met him. Verse 2, Genesis 32, and when Jacob saw them, he said, "This is God's host." And he called the name of that place Mahanaim. Now, here's the thing. Jacob saw a host. He knew that it was the Lord that was fighting the battle. This was the same host that David was going to hear as they came forward, as they began to move. Now, you and I would have looked and said, no, it was just some wind in the trees. You see, I don't know about you, but I was kind of reminded of that even yesterday. I raked up one side of my yard and I cleaned off the driveway and everything. And it was as if I took the last bit and I threw it in a bag and I hauled it off. All of a sudden, a wind came in and it didn't look like it did anything. But what was it? It was a wind in the top of the trees. But it wasn't just any wind. It was almost like the sound of a mighty rushing wind. I mean, if God could have opened our spiritual eyes like he did Jacob's on that day, then we would have seen the army of God marching into battle before us. And so God was saying, this time, David, I will do the work and you will reap the reward. I will do the work and you are going to reap the reward. You see, a lot of times we want to fight the battle because we want the credit. And what God's saying is you're not going to get the credit for the victory that takes place in your life. I don't know how many people want the credit for what they think that they're doing. I don't know how many times I've seen it. I've seen it over and over again. A person comes in, they're busted, disgusted, and they just can't go on anymore. And they've come to me and said, you know what, Pastor? I just feel like this is the end. I've lost my job. I've lost my house. I've lost everything. And I don't know what to do anymore. Can you pray for me? And I know I've sat down with many on that occasion. And I said, you know what? Here's what you need to do. You need to put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. You need to stop living for yourself. You need to put God first. And so this is what happens. And so they do. And they're crying and everything else. And then all of a sudden their life straightens up. And they get their job, a better job. They get a better house. They get a better this and a better that. But where are they? They got out of God what they wanted to get out of God, and they didn't. And then you go back and say, you ask them, well, how's everything going? Well, I got a new job, and I got myself a new house, and I have been doing all of this. And see, and this is the problem with so many people. This is the problem with so much ministry that goes on in the name of Christ. There is so much of I in the mix that we've got to get rid of the trash. And God is not going to move in that kind of a thing. David was a great king because David was a humble king. David knew where his power and where his authority came from. You see, I also think about this, that the first time God looked at David and said, okay, this is what I'm going to do. And see, in the first time, it was a testing of David's faith. He said to David, he said, what you're going to do is they came up in the front. He says, I want you to just face them dead on. It's going to be a strenuous battle. It's going to be a hard battle. It's going to be a battle, but you're going to win and you're going to overtake them every bit of the way. And so awesome, great. God's going to give me the victory, but I'm going to have to work for it. You see, it also speaks a little bit of the Old Testament. You had to work, do a lot of work and do a lot of on your own. The second battle kind of speaks of the New Testament, where God says, he says, now Jesus Christ has done the work for you. Remember, on Wednesday, I was talking about a song that I had listened to, so 10th Avenue North. It says, he says, you're free to struggle, but you're not struggling to be free. You're free to struggle if you want to, but the battle has already been won because God has defeated the enemy for you. And so you're free to struggle if you want to, and there's many people that are still trying to do things on their own, instead of putting their complete trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. But here's the thing. God, this is a testing of our faith. And I love this because on Wednesday nights we've been getting into this. And it's been so powerful, if you ask me. I've in just in studying and being able to minister this, I have received so much lately on Wednesday nights. That where God is talking about faith, and what that faith is the continued believing. It's the continued action upon God's word. Because faith is an act based upon a belief supported by the confidence of God's word. And so when we think about faith, it means a continued action. It means that you don't quit, you don't stop, even in the midst of a trial. And we kind of unfolded this a little bit with Job, and it's even right here in this passage of scripture where the testing of Job's faith was on trial. That many of us, our faith is on trial. David's faith was on trial, even right here. Will you trust me when everything's going right? Yeah, it's easy to trust God when everything's going right, right? It's easy to trust God when you've got $1 million in the bank and all your kids are fine and everything's paid for and your house is still standing and all. But what about when the stock market falls and everything you've worked for the last 50 years is gone? What about when your house burns down and you don't even have a car to your name and you don't even have a checkbook to write anything out? I'm telling you, can you still trust God? See, this is where faith comes in. Faith is the continued action based upon God's word, supported by God's word. You see, are you going to act the same way when you're going through a struggle as when everything is going well? It's easy, as I said, but my goodness, you get into a struggle, you want to kiss. I mean, you want to cuss, you want to fight. You want to rebel, you want to run the other way, you want to curse God, you want to shake your fist at God, you want to get mad, you want to question God, but real faith says, I'm going to keep acting the way that I've always acted. Why? Because God said that he would deliver me. See, it's the continued acting upon God's word, and this was David. God gave me the victory one time, he'll give it to me again, but I have to know where the victory comes from and how to do it God's way. The reason why so many people are still struggling is because, as I said, you continue to do it your way. And that's the definition of insanity, doing the same thing and expecting a different result. And some of you are going insane today because you got struggles in your life. You're facing giants. You're facing the same thing you've been facing for the past 5, 10, 15, 20 years. And you can't seem to get victory. I can tell you why. It's simple. Have you inquired of God? Oh yeah, I pray here and there. No, I'm not talking about that kind of inquire. I can guarantee you David didn't say, okay, God, what's it going to be? And then God gave him an answer. I know that we read that in the scripture, but I can guarantee you David stayed in the presence of God. But that was something that David always did. It wasn't that David ran to God just because trials came. David always stayed in the presence of God, inquiring of God. As he said, one thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after, that I may behold the beauty and inquire in his temple. I have a privilege today so that I can look upon God, I can see what he desires, and I get to ask him and inquire into that endless knowledge and wisdom of God, the depths of God's wisdom. I get to know what the creator of the universe is up to. So these two battles, they help us illustrate something. It's the difference between God's method in normal evangelism on one hand and his method of revival on another. What do you mean? You see, because a lot of times what evangelism is evangelism is getting your hands dirty and going out there and doing the hard work. It's doing the hard work. It's going out there and equipping yourself, making sure that you're ready, studying to show yourself approved, a workman who is worthy of his hire. I'm telling you, study to show yourself approved. I mean, look at the word of God, rightly divide the word of God. Study to show yourself. Then you go out there and you begin to witness. It's going to take time. It's going to take effort. It's going to take all of it. But when revival comes, it's out of your hands and mine. It's up to God. And I'm not just talking about revival on a wide scale, which it is. But I'm talking about on an individual basis in your life. Because before revival ever gets out into the open, it always starts right here in the heart of the individual. And so what are we going to do? See, in the first, this normal evangelism, it's going to take an effort. It's man's activity with the divine, his aid in his prominence working in our lives. The second, it is God who goes into the battle, and man has only to move in the train of his victory and gather the spoils that are left behind. See, this is the beauty of revival. Revival has so much to take from it, but I think one of the greatest reasons God hasn't given us revival yet is because you got too many greedy Christians. They want revival because they want a name for themselves. They want to be able to say, look what I've done. Look at all my labor. Look at all the hours that I prayed. Look at all the time that I spent in God's word. Look at all of this and look at all of that. And God's looking for the king who will say, God, we were watching just a little movie last night on Solomon, and we saw David sitting there on his deathbed, and I looked over at my wife and I said, I wonder, even at that moment when David was on his deathbed, if he was thinking, how in the world did I get from the shepherd's stall, from the sheep stall, to being here ruling the children of Israel in the palace? I think he was always in awe how God took him from the bottom and took him to the top. But I can tell you why. Because David wasn't willing to take the credit for himself. Every time something came towards him, he gave it to God. Saul has killed his thousands, but David his tens of thousands. And David would turn it over to God. That's not me, God. That's you. You see, but we want. Recognition for what we've done. We want to build a name for ourselves. And for this reason, I do believe that we haven't seen revival in the manner and to the extent. Why? Because it's all a show. I'm telling you, we've gotten real professional about things. And revival isn't professionalism. Revival isn't emotionalism. And I don't care what if we are going to measure revival on emotionalism, then guess what? It's going to go up and down every week. So I can tell you this, I've preached long enough to know that one Sunday, man, you could be up here. The next Sunday, boy, you could be under the dirt. If you go by emotionalism, if you go by feelings, if you go by just merely looking at an outward thing, but that isn't revival at all. Revival, again, I believe is faith in action. It is continuing to believe God no matter what the circumstances are, no matter what comes our way. So David, God is saying to David, he says, I'm going to do the work this time and you get to reap the benefit. But I'm going to get the glory out of it. And see, and God wants the glory out of your life. He doesn't want you to think, I'm telling you, he wants to bless you, but he doesn't want you to get the glory out of it. And I honestly believe most of why we're not blessed in the manner that we should be is because we keep trying to achieve something that only God can achieve in our lives. And if he was to give it to you and I, and it doesn't matter, we think we know ourselves. But I thank God for people like David who said, there's no good thing in me. In this heart, everything is wicked. And he understood that. He recognized that. And he wasn't about to bank on his own heart. So he looked to God and he said, God, if anything's to be done in my life, it'll be for the glory and the honor of your name. And I will receive no glory. And I believe that in these moments, when we come to a place where we're willing to get rid of our own self and push it aside and say, you know what, God, I want whatever you want and you can have all the glory. Then God can move in our lives and we can reap the benefits of the blessings of God. And every promise is yes and amen. But as long as we still want to get the credit for it, we're not going to do anything. We can get emotional, we can do a lot of things, but we're not going to see the power of God. I believe also what God is speaking to us is that revival doesn't come the same way every time. It doesn't come the same way every time. It doesn't happen like you want it to happen, just because you think it should happen this way. See, this is where the continued dependence upon God comes in. It's a continued dependence upon God. You say, you can look at it all through the Word, and even in this instance, it is a perfect demonstration of that very point. It was David's continued dependence upon God. Now, if David would have said, you know what, I'm going to go and I'm going to fight him just like I did the last time, guess what? David would have lost. And he would have failed. And he would have failed miserably. But God wanted to do something and David was inquiring. See, we have to understand this. And we cannot mistake the blessings of God. When he gives us a revival, whether personal or at large, we cannot try and take the credit for it. I wanna focus again on the sound of marching. It's a sound of revival that is heard by those that are in the battle. It's not heard by those that sit on the sidelines. You have to be in the right place at the right time with the right people. Let me say that again. You have to be in the right place at the right time and with the right people. You see, the sound that you're going to hear when God begins to do something is because you have positioned yourself for battle. David didn't sit back and say, okay, God, this is my enemy. You go out and do it. No, David got out there. He was ready to war. And he's just like, okay, God, here we are. If he'd have sat in the palace, he'd have never heard the army of God moving. He'd have never reaped the benefits. He'd have never got the reward of what God wanted to do in his life. And so many of us, we become lazy. We don't want to pray. We don't want to seek God. We don't want to do the things that we're supposed to. We don't want to study. We don't want to do the evangelism part. And so guess what? You're not going to hear the sound of revival. You're not going to hear the move of God. But when we're in the right place, at the right time, and with the right people, I don't know about you, but this didn't sound like much of a revival at the time. This was a time of war. This was a time when the enemy was attacking David. This was a time of disarray. And a lot of us, we come to this place and we think, no, this can't be. But I don't want to get ahead of myself. I want to get there, But just as there are in scriptures, it constantly reminds us that there are signs of the coming of Christ. There are also signs of a coming of revival when God sends a revival. And so revival will not come, first of all, without inquiring of God. It will not come without inquiring of God. You can hope it all day long, but until you set your heart and your mind to inquiring of God and setting in His presence, you will be defeated. you'll be that defeated Christian. Isaiah 42 in verse 9 says this, Isaiah 42 and 9, "Behold, the former things are come to pass, and new things do I declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them." So here's what God is saying. The thing old is past. The time is past. Oh, hold on. See, the sound of marching has to be analyzed and described so that now in this present time, our ears can be tuned in to hear what God is doing. Here's the thing. We are so concerned with what God did that we cannot see what God is about to do. You see, this is the problem that has happened all through the ages. It happens in our personal lives. It happens in the church at large. How many times have you heard the phrase, "Oh, what God did back then, and when God did this, and what God did." And we're always waiting for God to do it the same way, and what God did, and what God was going to do. And we want to repeat, but we think He's going to do it the same way. But here He tells us, "Behold, the former things have come to pass." That revival has come and gone. And He says, "I do a new thing." And He says, "But before I do it, I'm going to tell you about it. I'm going to let you hear the rustling of the wind through the tops of the trees. You're going to hear the host of the armies going before you into battle." I don't know about you, but this time prior to is a building up. This time prior to is you and I preparing ourselves for what is coming. That's why the Bible says don't get tired of doing good, because in due season you will reap a harvest if you don't quit. The problem is we quit. They that sow in tears. Why? Because it's backbreaking. Work to the bone. Work your fingers to the bone. Every day, day in and day out, just doing what God has commanded you to do. And you just keep going. See, this is the beauty of revival. I hope you get this. It is the continued, as we said, and it just so ties in with faith. It's the continued action. It's the continued doing what you know to do is right until you hear that moving of God in your midst. You see, it's in the everyday. It's getting up. It's taking some time to pray. It's reading your Bible. It's going out there. It's witnessing. It's telling people who Christ is. It seems monotonous. It seems redundant. You get up and it seems sometimes like just a cycle. You're going over and over. And it's just, what is it? It's the continued acting in faith, being a believer, doing always those things that are pleasing to God. This was a scripture that I had referenced even on Wednesday. Just doing, that's why when we come to God, we know that we will get what we want. Why? Because we do always those things that are pleasing in His sight. Here's the thing. It's the redundancy. It's the doing every day, day in, day out. David sat and he inquired in the temple. I'm sure that it wasn't every day that David felt this, the presence of God like he did the next day. But David went the next day anyway because he knew that that was what was required and expected of him if God was going to do anything in his life. And the problem, one of the issues is we as humans are so inconsistent in our seeking God. Everything's going, "Oh, I'll seek God, or I may not seek God. Just depends on what I feel like today. Just depends on how everything is going." But see, this is the beauty, is it comes to those who are continuing to suit up for battle, who go out there every single day. It's the police officer that puts on that uniform every single day and goes out there. It's the soldier that gears up and he goes out there every single day. He's ready for battle. Nothing may happen today, but a victory will come if he goes out there every single day and continues to do what he knows that he's supposed to do. But what do we do? Well, I really don't feel like going out and fighting a battle today, so I'm just going to sit around and you know, do what I want to do, and I'm not going to be consistent. And I can tell you this, you'll never experience revival, and you'll never experience the true victory of Jesus Christ in your life. We cannot be too careful when we begin to come to this. And when we begin to look at the evidences of revival, General Booth, he wrote to his eldest daughter. She was discouraged during a time in the early days of her work in Paris. And the general advised her to keep her eyes off the waves and fix them on the tide. See, one of the things that we many times do is we look at every situation that comes our way. Even as Peter, when he got out and all he could see was the waves. And I can tell you, this is the everyday. This is the everyday. It's up and down. And if you look at your eyes, I mean, if you look at the waves and you keep your eyes on the waves, you can't see the ebb and flow. You can't see that tide coming in and that tide going out. You know, you can't stop that. I remember reading some time ago or seeing some time ago on the History Channel. It was a couple years, some years ago, that when they were building this one bridge, they had such massive amounts of weight that they could not find any heavy equipment to lift. So what they did was they built these barges and they put the equipment on there and they waited for the tide to come in. And when the tide came in, it raised it up. See, if we're looking at the waves, we're just like a double-minded person who is unstable in all their ways, because everything is dependent upon how I feel. Everything is dependent upon how life is going for you. Everything is dependent upon the natural. But when we see the tide coming in and out, then we realize that everything is dependent upon God and a force that we cannot control. See, to be occupied with the waves, that's the ebb and flow of the spiritual battle. It's to lose sight of who is in control. And we begin to feel rejected or dejected. We feel like we're all alone, even when we're not. And it's the unconquerable power of the tide that matters. Moving into our next is there's a spirit of lawlessness and deadness all about us. Now here's the thing. Your circumstances cannot control your outcome. Now it's up to you, but your circumstances cannot control your outcome. If you put your trust in God, they can't. But Pastor, what I'm going through today, everything looks bleak. Everything looks grim. Nothing is lining up. There's no way that God can do anything. Nobody can do anything. And I just kind of step back and smile because I'm thinking, now it's time for God. You see, now God can do something. Because now you've come to a place where you've realized that you can't do anything. And no one in this world can do anything. See, when you look at everything, all that is going on, it's strange, but it's true. That the prevalence of lawlessness in our world and all of the deadness that's in the church is often an indication of impending revival. What? Yes. When you look and you see the lawlessness, and when you see the powerlessness of the church, I'm not talking about activity. There's always activity. You can go anywhere in the world, and it may even seem like a good thing. Because I tell you, most what we call revival today is dependent upon our emotions and how we feel. Oh, God is moving because I feel so good. That doesn't mean God's moving. How many of you feel good if somebody wrote you out a check for $1 million? Does that mean God's moving? That's emotionalism. And see, and we've learned, Hollywood has learned better than anyone to work on emotions. They can put a movie together. I'm telling you, there's sometimes I'm watching a commercial and I'm just kind of like trying to fight back tears. And I'm like, what is this? See, they've learned to play on your emotions, because if they can play on your emotions, they can get something out of you that they want. And most of the time, it's your money. But see, when God begins to move and He fights the battle, there's something in it. Maybe that one went right over. You see, when God fights the battle and He begins to move, there's something in it for everyone. It's not a drain on you. It's an increase on you of joy, of strength, of peace, of power, maybe even financially. There's something to be gained when God is moving. But when they play on your emotions, get ready, because they're about to make a draw on you. And see, and this is what, it's spiritual deadness that's in the church. You say, well, Pastor, you can really say, yes, I can say that. And I can say that without batting an eye. Because there's been so much of it in the world. Now, here's the thing. When we look around and we see that things are bleak and things are dark, even at this moment, it is perfect. It's a perfect time for God to begin to do something powerful. See, Psalm 119, I want you to turn there. Psalm 119. I've heard a lot of people quote this verse, but they don't quote it in its entirety. They don't quote it in its entirety. And this is where the problem lies. Because we just want God to do something, right? We just want God to do something. When we look out and the world seems dark and the world seems black and it just seems like nothing is going right. When we look at the churches and the word is, there's a word being spoken, but it's not the full word of God. We sometimes get excited because, oh, it sounds so good. But for anyone who is spiritual, they can tell the difference. Because a little leaven leavens the whole lump. Meaning a little bit of a lie taken away or put in ruins the whole thing. You leave something out of the Word of God, it changes the whole structure of it. And so what's happening is those of us who have our ears spiritually attuned, because there's a lot of times I'll turn on a TV and I just got to the point where I have to be quiet anymore because my wife doesn't want to hear it sometimes. And I think my kids don't want to hear it. I hear a song come on and I start saying something. And one of them said to me the other day, Dad, come on. Like, let me just enjoy the song. I don't need your input. Why? Because spiritually tuned ears can hear the false. They can detect what is wrong. And I can tell you this, I've turned on that TV many times. And I've listened, and there's so much that pastor, preacher, teacher will be speaking such a good word. And there will be so much good truth out of it. And then all of a sudden, there's one thing injected or one thing taken. And I'm just like, you just ruined it. It's not that I couldn't, as a spiritual person, I could learn. But how many people are you deceiving? And this is why. And this is what the Bible tells us in Psalm 119 and verse 126. That's why I didn't give it to you, because you'd have gone there and you would have read it before me. 126, verse 126. It is time for thee, Lord, to work. Why? Why, somebody? Why? Because they have made void your law. See, I've heard that many times. It's time for God to work. Oh, it's time for God to work. And let me just get on your emotions a little bit. And let me get you all excited, standing up, so that when I pull out an offering plate up here, come on, and the next person puts it. For what? I could do that. I could do that all day long. But I'd be apostate. And I'd be a heretic. It's time for you to work, O Lord. Why? Because they've disregarded everything you've said. They don't care about what you said anymore. They don't care about your word. It's come to a place where instead of taking the word of God for what it is, for the absolute truth of God's word, they say they now question. Well, that was because it was written back then. Let me ask you this. Do you think God inhabits eternity's future right now? Absolutely. You and I don't understand that. Never will understand it. We are confined to time and confined to time limits. But in eternity, there is no such thing as time. You think that what God said back then is null and void now? And so we come and we want to change the word like we change our clothes or the style of our clothes. This morning, I got up and I told my wife, I put on a suit, and it's great suit. And I looked at her and I said, man, this thing looks old anymore. And I said, I'm going to have to go back and change. But you see, we want to change the word of God like that because we think, oh, well, God's word, you know, somehow has to change because our times have changed. Can I tell you this? God doesn't change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And why is it time for God to work? Because they have disregarded what you have commanded and what you have said. Every man does what's right in his own eyes. Every man does what's right in his own eyes. And he's not talking about the world. He's talking about the church. Why? Because if you go to that church, that's why the Bible says they'll find somebody to tickle their ears. Because if you go to the church down the street, they're going to tell you this thing. And if you go down to another church, if you didn't like that one, I'm sure you could find one out there that'll suit you perfectly. And they're going to tell you what you want to hear just so that you'll stay. And it's going to be hard. And I'm not saying that they're not out there, but it's going to be hard to find a church that is going to tell you the truth. Just the way that God wants it to be, just so you don't get offended. They're going to tell you, oh, you can do this and you can do that. And hell has sold a lot of lies. And so they've made void the law of God. They've allowed things to come into their belief system that God never allowed. And this is what the psalmist is saying. They disregard your word. The people of Israel have disregarded your word. It's time for you to work. And so a lot of times what happens in the working of God, in God's infinite wisdom, he would take the children of Israel and bring them into captivity. He would allow destruction unbelievable to come upon their land. I mean, in one day, they would lose everything. Homes, land, family. They'd be taken into Babylon or under somebody else's power. Why? Because it was time for God to work. Because they made void his laws. And I can tell you this. We are on the precipice this morning. Where they have made void the laws of God. And I'm not talking about just merely on a you know, all-out scale. But I'm talking about on an individual scale. I can guarantee you I could almost go through this room one by one and I'd get different views on different parts of the scripture that aren't even biblical. You say, what do you mean, Pastor? Why? Because there are certain scriptures we've fashioned to mean what we want them to mean because we want them to suit us rather than just take it for God's word and say, you know what, God, if it offends me, then let it offend me. But let your word be true and every man a liar. Oh, I can do this because the Bible doesn't say, no, why are you doing that? Because you want to do it, not because God knew. There's something in your spirit. There's a check in your spirit. You're not listening. You blow past that. You've made void the law of God. What does the Bible tell us? If you fail in one part, you've what? Failed the whole part. See, a little leaven leavens a whole lot. I don't have any other gods before him. I don't, you know, serve any graven image. I go to church on the Sabbath day, and I do all of this, and but you know, I sure do like to have my tobacco here and there. Wait a minute, the Bible doesn't talk about tobacco. Do you know in your spirit you're the temple of the Holy Ghost? Don't you know that you're supposed to be taking care of your body? Don't you know that you're supposed to be doing? Oh, God, help me. I don't want to get on that. I'm just going to stir things up even further. We make void the laws of God. Then we wonder why everything starts falling apart. We wonder why our marriages don't work out. We wonder why our families don't work out. We wonder why our businesses don't work out. We wonder why everything's not working out, because I can tell you this, because you're not obeying what God has commanded. You're not doing what he's told us to do. So in the middle of it all, in the middle of just chaos, God comes about and he begins to move. You see, when the night is darkest, that's because the dawn is on its way. The Bible tells us to look up, for our redemption draws nigh. That God is about to move because everything is looking bleak. You know, for those of us who are not willing to hide ourselves our head in the sand and not willing to stand in denial and say, oh, well, everything's good and everything's fine and everything looks good. And you know, one thing that I was reminded of even yesterday, a good friend of mine called me and he said, don't use me in your message. Here you are. But I was reminded of that very thing. That you know, we want God to do something. We want him to do it our way. And he's not going to do it just because you and I want him to do it like that. We have to give him all the glory. So we our redemption draws nigh. We look at the world that is around us, and I told my friend, I said, you know, I don't even watch the local news around where I live anymore. Why? Because I don't want to be discouraged, and I want to be able to lay my head down in peace at night sometimes. I don't know about you. But you look at that news, and all you can hear is this has happened, that person was killed, somebody over here, this and that. I mean, that. If it's not bad news, it ain't news at all. And then at the very end, they'll give one little highlight. Ooh, and this happened to it. As if that just makes void everything that they just said. But it's looking at the world, looking at what's happening, and just sitting in denial and saying, you know what? It's not real. It's not happening. We're like that child who pulls the covers up over his head when he's afraid at night. And says, there's, you know, this isn't happening. This isn't happening, as if his blanket could cover him. Finney says this: the providence of weakness or of wickedness is not evidence at all that there is not going to be a revival. That is often God's time to work. See, when we look around and we see the wickedness taking place in our world, it's not evidence that God is not going to work. It means that God is about to do something. See, it has to be this way. Speaking on the 18th century revival, Dr. P.V. Jenness said, every student of history knows that the dawn of the 18th century was a time of material prosperity in England. The colonies were pouring their wealth into the mother country. And it was a day of luxury, dishonesty, speculation, and extravagance. It was followed by severe panic when the South Sea bubble collapsed. It was a time of increased intellectual activity and expression. The freedom of worship secured through the Reformation had degenerated into license to defy all authority, human and divine. Hobbes and Lockley made infidelity popular. Gibbon and Hume devoted their talents to discrediting the church. Billingbroke and Shaftesbury, among statesmen, helped to create an atmosphere of spiritual chill. Everything, prior to the Reformation, everything was beginning to go downhill. It had become religion at its best. It had become just something that everybody talked about. And it gave everybody the right to do again what was right in their own eyes. And I won't take very much longer if someone wants to come. If you want to come, Jessica. See, the Reformation was a spent force. It had run its course at this point. And the ministry was largely corrupt. Blackstone, the author of the Commentaries of Law, writes that he sought in vain for a sound gospel preacher in London. And I want you to hear this. He sought in vain for a sound gospel preacher in London. The Sabbath was a day of general carousal. Public blasphemy was common. Current literature and common conversation and was lasciviousness and corrupt. God was defiled. The outlook was dark indeed. Here and there, a few godly men and women were crying unto God for revival. The scene was bleak and absolutely utter in despair, and it was a cesspool at this point. Granted, a revival had already swept across that land and across that time. And we've seen our share. It sounds like the day that we're living in today. We have seen the actual, and those of us who have experienced and know the truth, we know that what we see in our present day isn't what we're looking for. A lot of activity. A lot of things are going on. I would dare say even in your life, personally, there's a lot of people struggling knowing that, man, this isn't the move of God that I've been expecting. Something isn't right in my life. If God is real, there's got to be more. If God is real, there's got to be more. If God is really my God, there's got to be more. They were facing this worldwide. And that's the way it was then. In those wicked times, the Lord made bare his holy arm in the eyes of all the nations. And that the ends of the earth might see his salvation. And he had begun to stir, began to move. Three men were born in 1703. Prior to all of this, John Wesley in England, Gilbert Tennent in Ireland, Jonathan Edwards in Massachusetts. 11 years later, George Whitefield was born. You see, God saw there was a few people praying, wanting God, and truly desiring God. You see, it's just like David as he's crying out, as the psalmist is crying out in 119. It is time for you to work. There was still somebody crying out to God because he could see what was happening. They've made void your law. They don't even regard you as holy anymore. They don't even look to you as honorable and faithful and true. They don't honor you. They could have almost come up into the king's throne and just disgraced it. because they didn't consider the king to be anything anymore. And I would dare say that there's a lot of people that are sitting in a church today and they don't consider God, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, something to be honored and someone to be worshiped and someone to be praised that deserves our every bit of our service and of our honor and of everything that we have, of every moment of our life. No, we look at God and we see Him as, you know, if you're up there, you know, I'm here and you need to serve me. We don't say that, but that's what we're saying is you need to serve me. I've got an issue. I've got problems. You need to take care of them. In other words, come and serve. Instead of seeing Him as the King of Kings, realizing that in our heart and mind, and every morning falling at His feet and just utter reverence and saying, God, I'm here, your servant. You deserve my all. You deserve everything that I am. Without you, I'm nothing. Without you, I have nothing. Without you, I'll never be anything. These four men were the agents of a great spiritual awakening that broke out across England and America. The strange fact that the river of blessings is often flowing at its lowest level prior to an awakening of the Spirit of God. It's something that has continued throughout history. You see, whenever we look around, all things are changing. We're hoping. I think sometimes that's just wishful thinking. Oh, things are changing. Things are changing. I can tell you this. With my spiritual eyes open, things have never been worse than they are today. Spiritually, the world is in moral decay. Everything's accepted. You think about the things that are being brought into the church. Jonathan Edwards, in his thoughts on revival in New England, he wrote this. Who that saw the state of things in New England a few years ago, the state that it was settled in, and the way that we had been so long in going, who would have thought that in so short a time there would be such a change? Again, he writes, how dead a time it was everywhere before this work began. You see, the one thing that is evident is that God doesn't gradually build up. I love what God does. He does it in a moment. Why? Because if it gradually builds up, you could take the credit for it. You and I can say, well, you know what? I made my own. I'm a self-made person. No. See, when God began to move, He moved suddenly, so much so that shortly after the 1904 revival broke out, the Liverpool Daily wrote this: if I had been asked a month ago whether a revival was probable in Wales, I would have answered no. It seemed to me that the higher criticism had totally wrecked the machinery of revival, and that until theology had been reshaped in accordance with its conclusions, nothing would happen to disturb the prevailing apathy. 1 month ago, you couldn't convince me that God was going to move. So we see these little things, a little pocket here, and we say, oh, there's revival. And then we see a little pocket there, and we say, oh, there's revival. Oh, there's revival over here. Oh, that's not how God works. God says, if I'm going to do it, nobody's getting the credit for it. And He says, and when I do it, I'm going to sweep the land in a moment. And I'm going to change everything now. So I can tell you this. You can say what you want. There's no prevailing revival right now. How can you say that, Pastor? There's moves here and there. Yeah, there might be. There are truly some people of God that God is moving in. But revival? No. Why? Because when you see revival, you can't mistake it. What do you mean? The world will not be able to mistake revival. You see, the world, I remember reading some time ago, they said this present day revival, they say that is going on has not changed society. There's no change in society. When God sent a powerful move in His revival, it changed not just the church, but it changed even the lawmakers and everyone that was out on the outskirts. So don't tell me about revival. Until we see God's hand move, I will continue to pray until He does something so powerful that not even our president or anyone else will be able to mistake what God is doing in our land. You say, well, that sounds like you're really hoping for a lot. Would I expect any less from God? Would I expect any less from God? Absolutely not. God is going to do it. How do you know? Because the glory of the latter house will be greater than that of the former house. His word, it will come to pass. It will not return to Him void. He will do it. And I'm going to pray until it happens.